Father, we pray that you'll be with us, make this a profitable time, we would ask, as we think about things where Christians often differ. Help us to think clearly, to differ spiritually in appropriate ways, and to learn from one another. So to that end, we ask that you'd be with us. In Christ's name, amen. So we are at the start of chapter 4, at the end of chapter 3, whatever. We're sort of in the middle between between those two. We've, as one old analogy is, we're caught between trapezes. We let go of chapter 3, and chapter 4 hasn't arrived yet. And I just want to take this week, and I thought it would be this week, but it's going to be next week as well, talking about some things that are kind of basic, so you help, you can understand where I am going in the rest of in Revelation, and so you can understand some of the ways in which Christians have differed in their understanding of future things, and the book of Revelation obviously becomes part of that whole process. So, where I want to begin tonight is talking about what, for want of a better term, I'm borrowing a phrase of Al Mohler, or a view of Al Mohler, who's a seminary president in Louisville. He calls it theological triage. Now, we've got some nurses here, and they are probably much better equipped than I am to talk about triage. But in a very simple way, if you end up going into emergency, the first person you see is the triage nurse, and it's their responsibility to make some kind of decision about what kind of classification are you in. Are you look after immediately? Are you, this is important, but it needs, it can wait? We've got somebody coming in with a heart failure, and are you going to sit here for 3 hours because you're in a third order thing? It may be really annoying to have that wound, but it can be held shut in different ways. And if you've ever sat in an emergency room, you know the difference between being first order and third order. But it's a little bit different. I'd always rather be third order when I go into the emergency room in any kind of thing, even if I have to put up for the wait. Now, it's useful to think in those terms, because when we come to biblical truth, theological truth, it's useful to think, what are first-order issues, what are second-order issues, and what are third-order issues? Now, not everyone would put things in the same category, but first-order issues are really the kind of issues that probably put you in some sense within the level of, is this a person, an Orthodox Christian or not? And so you get important questions related to the nature of Christ. Is he divine or is he God? We all know you can say a lot of important things or nice things about Christ, but what are you really saying about him? I was reading a discussion today between an evangelical and a Mormon, and it's really interesting that you can use the same terms but mean something significantly different by those terms. And you ask the question, what is of first-order importance? What is of second-order importance? And what is of third-order importance? Now, to say that something is of third-order importance is not to say it's unimportant. And sometimes we, when we say something is important and something is less important, we run in, for example, I would put as an issue of first-order importance justification by faith. I would put as an issue of second importance, baptism. Now, if you try to put baptism on the same level as justification by faith, and of course there are groups that include baptism as part of justification by faith, you begin to see why you need to separate those two. But baptism is the command of the Lord. I mean, it's not irrelevant. And yet Christians have differed on that. So with baptism, you've got the question of, is it going to be paedo-baptism, baptism of children, or credo-baptism, baptism on the basis of faith, personal faith in Christ. And saying it's a second-order issue is still saying it's a command for every believer, and churches have to make some decisions. Are we going to say it's an issue that is required for membership, or is it something that, and obviously a Baptist church, or a Lutheran church, or a Presbyterian church, take a little bit different views on those kind of things. And then on a third level, in terms of baptism, you might have the issue of immersion, sprinkling, or pouring. Sorry, I was trying to think, what was the third thing they do to people? The meaning of baptism is obviously more important than the method of baptism, which is not to say the method of baptism is not important. I'm a convinced believer in baptism by immersion. I think that's the biblical practice. But if somebody was in a hospital bed and they wanted to be baptized and they hadn't been, I would have no problem going in and sprinkling them as a sign of baptism and be fully convinced that they had done the right thing. And so you begin to put things in a different level of order. And so one of the things you wrestle with over the years about what things belong in what category and where do we draw lines between that. So let's talk about prophecy. Let's talk about eschatology. What are the first order issues related to eschatology, to prophecy, as you think about them? And you throw out a few, then I'll tell you what I think is the right answer, and we'll go from there.
Second coming.
Yeah. Second coming, but help me with that. What do you mean by second coming?
Just when Christ returns to the earth. Not necessarily the rapture, but when he actually returns.
Okay. Now, I'm going to push you on that a little bit, Alan. Sorry, we've got the microphone thing. It's going to be a little bit harder. It's going to be a little bit harder in this discussion. So, so when you talk about the second coming, help me unpack that a little bit, because some people say he comes in a spiritual way. Others would say,
I would say the bodily second coming of Christ.
Okay, I mean, I'm trying to push this because we want to define it carefully. We're talking about a literal, personal, physical return of Christ to earth.
Right, yes.
Okay, I mean,
that's
just trying,
good.
To, just
that's
trying good. To define it, because second coming, I don't want to say it in such a way that we're not defining what that means. So, okay, I'm all for that. And anything else related to eschatology? Is that all we're going to talk about?
There will be a judgment.
Okay. That there is a judgment of all people. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Final judgment, however, last judgment, however you want to say that. Anything else you think is a first order issue, Charles?
The millennium.
Okay. We'll hold a little bit back on that one. I may put that in another category, but let's... another one? Stephen? I mean, Connor? call him by my son's
You
name.
Just told me
Oh, you've got my notes. You can't read from my notes.
The resurrection, bodily resurrection of
okay,
believers.
Okay, the bodily resurrection of believers. And there's a sense in which you say the bodily resurrection in a general sense, because there's the resurrection of life and the resurrection until death. But let's talk about the bodily resurrection of believers to make it specific in that way. Anyone else have something that they think is a first order truth that you're being sub-Christian if you didn't believe in that?
Although the Bible doesn't use the term the rapture of believers.
Okay. I wouldn't put that as a first order one, but let's Now, we've talked about the resurrection of believers. So every believer, in terms of first order, every believer is going to have a resurrection body. So that's a first order issue.
Not the resurrection, I meant, I said the rapture.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Bob.
Well, this isn't a top priority, but probably second is the imprisonment of Satan for that 1,000 years.
Okay, that's more specifically on that, but I think you could put in terms of the general judgment, you would have the final dealing with Satan as well as a first order issue, which the millennium isn't. It's as far as Revelation being confined for 1,000 years and then released, but then he is put into the bottomless pit forever. So the eternal confinement of Satan, I think that
we're gonna... Antichrist and Armageddon.
Okay. Let me suggest those are not first order issues, but they're somewhere on a list.
How about the new heavens and the new earth and our eternity with God?
Okay. The new heavens and the new earth. I want to push some of you former Adventists to another one that has not been mentioned that's fairly important. Watch your language.
What the hell?
Hell.
I said hell.
Yes, quite a few had here. Okay. But quite a few have been saying hell. They've been having a good time saying it, Elizabeth. So. Okay. Hell, heaven, new heavens and the new earth, those come together in some way. Charles?
Seal of God.
The seal of God. Well, of course, that has to be defined as to what that means. But whatever it is, it's not a first order issue.
According to, for prophecy, would it be that the prophecy is now ended? There is no more to be added. Would that be a first order?
Of course, now we're moving. That's into a little bit of a different subject. Although prophecy is in there, that would be more in terms of the doctrine of the Bible and the nature of Scripture. But it's also in the doctrine of the Holy Spirit in terms of spiritual gifts. So let me just suggest to you, and this obviously did not come inspired from heaven, I would think that as you're thinking about first-order issues related to prophecy, the first and the most important is the physical, bodily, personal return of Christ to the earth. That is a central issue, and it's part of the creeds. And that when he comes, as a result of his coming, there will be the bodily resurrection of believers. That believers will be raised to new life. A third issue connected into all of those is the final judgment. These are ones that have all been said. And then the reality of hell. I think that biblically, I know there was some that would not put that as a first order, but I find very difficult not to have that as a first order issue. And then the new heavens and the new earth, the new creation that God is going to give. Now, when we come to a second order issue, and we're thinking now where Christians have differed over the years, I would put the millennium into that category. Now, all Christians believe in the millennium. They just define it completely differently. So, a Christian's going to believe in the millennium. Even the amillennialists believe in the millennium. Even though the term amillennium means no millennium. We'll get back to that in just a moment as we think about that. So Christians believe that Christ is reigning and ruling in a kingdom, and So on one level, you could say that the rule of Christ is a first-order issue, but in terms of the millennium, how what that looks like and the differences between those, we're now in a second-order kind of issue. Although people love to take pot shots at one another between the two, if you're pre-mill, then you're convinced that amillennialism is a terrible thing, and you would never eat post toasties. You won't have anything to do with post. It's easy to get into that kind of attitude, but it's a second-order issue. And let me suggest that third-order issues are the tribulation and the rapture. Again, that is not to say they are not important. Now, if we're talking about the rapture, and let's say we're really talking about the timing of the rapture or the nature of the rapture, because the rapture itself, that is that believers are going to be raised and receive a resurrection body, and living believers are going to be transformed to receive a resurrection body, that's the essence of the rapture issue. And there's a strong sense, I had a friend of mine who came to Trinity who, when he came, said, "I don't believe in the rapture." And I knew what he meant, but I said, "You have to." Because 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 to 18 is part of the Bible. What he meant was, "I don't understand it the way you understand it, and I would define it differently." So the timing of the rapture and the tribulation, the nature of the tribulation period. Is it a concentrated, focused at the end of history? Is it something that's extended through church history over a period of time? Is really a third order issue. And sincere Christians can disagree on that and believe differently. And it isn't an issue. It might be an issue that a local church decides that we take this particular view of things, and that's entirely fine. But to turn around and say other Christians who don't believe this are second-class Christians has a whole different kind of agenda. Do you understand the distinction I'm trying to make here? Because I think it becomes very important as we try to think our way through this. What is of central importance and what is of importance but secondary importance, and that helps me kind of keep my balance on some of these kinds of issues. So let's talk about the millennial issues and think our way through what different Christians believe. Now, all of these issues are far more complicated than we're going to have a chance to talk about. And obviously, I am going to simplify highly in all of them to try to say what they believe. But let's talk first about amillennialism. Now, that's on one level a relatively new term. The term millennium obviously means from Greek, milla is 1,000, and the eum comes from the word for years. So millennium is a period of 1,000 years. We understand that. In Greek, the word for 1,000 is kilia. And so they talk in the, if you read the early books about the early Christians, they'll talk about kiliasm, which means the same thing as millennium, millennialism. So the three basic schools are a, post, and pre. And millennium is a shorthand term for the reign of Christ, but specifically, there's a strong sense of an earthly reign of Christ. So amillennial, and this particular name didn't occur until the 20th century, amillennial, the a is the Greek way of saying un or non. It's, you know, a theist, atheist, a Gnostic, an agnostic, and it's a negative. So an amillennialist is somebody who does not believe in the physical reign of Christ on the earth in a bodily state. They believe he returns physically, but the central idea of amillennialism is that Christ is presently reigning. So the millennium is the spiritual reality, not an earthly physical reality. And it is by far the majority view of Christendom. The Catholic Church is amillennial. And beginning with Augustine especially, or Augustine, depending on how you pronounce his name, that became the dominant view. The Reformers largely kept that particular understanding. Christ is ruling and reigning in his church here and now. Now, it obviously takes a huge difference when you're talking about the Catholic understanding of the reign of Christ, in which he rules in his church, but it's through the hierarchy, to a Presbyterian understanding, an evangelical Presbyterian understanding of the reign of Christ, which is often deeply anti-Catholic in its way of understanding things, but still believes Christ is spiritually ruling in his church, but it has nothing to do with the kind of churchly hierarchy on that particular way. But the commonality of that is that the kingdom promises that are made and the kingdom promises that are given in the Old Testament are being spiritually fulfilled presently in the church, not in a future way in the millennial kingdom as it's perceived by premillennialists in the nation of Israel. So most who take this view, I think pretty much you could say all who believe this view do not believe in the restoration of the nation of Israel, although they do, some of them, a minority, do believe there's a future for Israel in the sense that there will be an end-time conversion of many Jews coming into the church. That's a minority view, but it still is a millennial view. But the idea of Israel as a nation being restored is not part of the vast majority of viewpoints on that. So, to give you kind of a short statement of it, the central idea is that we're now living in the millennium because the church, the new Israel, is the recipient of God's promises through Christ, who is the true Israel. So the promises that God made are being fulfilled in Christ, who is the true Israel. And the spiritual promises of the gospel are transcend the more physical material promises of the Old Testament. So they will say, it's like, as one of my friends said, it's like your dad promised you a bicycle and you end up getting a new sports car. You got better than was promised. What we have in Christ is better than those material promises of the Old Testament. So the Old Testament promises are to be understood symbolically, and the blessings are entirely spiritual. And when Christ returns, he will return, well, amillennialism says that during the present age, the kingdom of Christ is growing and the kingdom of Satan is growing, and there is increasing tension. And as you come to the end, there will be increasing trouble. And many see that there will be an actual Antichrist who will emerge. But Christ will come, and immediately after his coming and the destruction of evil, the new heavens and the new earth will take place. So let me read you the words of one proponent. Said the Old Testament spoke of the glories of the Messianic age that was coming, the age inaugurated by Christ in which the church now lives, in terms of their own age. So what they prophesied was in terms of their own age, and the religious blessings of God's people in that Old Covenant age. Central to these blessings were the concepts of the people of Israel, the land of Canaan, the city of Jerusalem, the temple, the sacrifices, and the throne of God. The prophets, by the Spirit's inspiration, spoke of the blessings God would pour out under the new covenant in terms of the typological images so familiar to the old covenant saints. Which means, when the Old Testament speaks of Jerusalem, it really means the church. When the Old Testament speaks of the temple, it's talking about, I mean, in the promises, about what's God going to do in the temple, it's really talking about the church. When it talks about the land, it's talking about the church. And so the church becomes the inheritor of the blessings. Now, it's not without its problems. One is that, and we'll come back to these when I talk, I'm not going to try and take the time to talk negatively about all of these, but one of the great challenges is, what way can you say in the present age Satan is bound? Because if you take Revelation as being symbolic of the present age and the kingdom is a symbolic thing, Satan is bound during this particular period of time. And there's an attempt to say he is relatively bound, that he's bound more than he would have been apart from the gospel. But Revelation talks about him being chained and put in a pit, which sounds a lot more permanent than just a temporary hold. So that's a major issue. And there's other issues that come up in Revelation 20, and some of those we will get to when we come to that particular place. For example, one of the issues is that when it talks about that passage and it says that they died, they were beheaded for the sake of Jesus, and they came to life. This is the first resurrection. And the first resurrection is viewed either as spiritual life, when you trust Christ, that the first resurrection is receiving eternal life, or it's dying and going to heaven. But the passage talks about people being beheaded and then talks about them coming to life after that, which doesn't sound a lot like either being born again, or if it is that they were beheaded and then they came to life, and that refers to going to heaven, then you're really saying come to life in that passage means they died. And that seems to be very strange. But that's it. So let's just pause here and see if I can muddy the waters any more for you in terms of amillennialism. Basic view, clear? Okay, postmillennialism takes a very different view. Postmillennial, although it's really a very close cousin in some ways to amillennialism, but what it says is that the kingdom, the millennium, is being brought into existence by the proclamation of the gospel, by the spread of the gospel in the world today. And that when the world has been Christianized, to use that particular term, which isn't entirely appropriate, then Christ will return. And let me read one statement of it. Postmillennialism expects the proclaiming of the Spirit-blessed gospel of Jesus Christ to win the vast majority of human beings to salvation in the present age. Increasing gospel success will gradually produce a time in history prior to Christ's return in which faith, righteousness, and prosperity will prevail in the affairs of people and of nations. After, there's the word post, an extensive era of such conditions, the Lord will return invisibly, bodily, and in great glory, ending history with the general resurrection and the great judgment of all mankind. So, amillennialism sees the growth of the kingdom, or the kingdom being spiritual blessings that are going on present, but in conflict constantly with evil. Postmillennialism says, no, evil is going to be defeated by the spread of the gospel in the world, and Gospel success will gradually produce a time in history prior to Christ's return in which faith, righteousness, and prosperity will prevail in the affairs of people and of nations. Now, postmillennialism sort of had its main impetus in about beginning in around 1600, and it grew after that in popularity, and it was the dominant idea in many ways in the 19th century, especially among more mainline churches, but also in other churches, and you can read some of the songs. I used to be amused because when I grew up, my mother listened every lunch hour to the Biola Hour. And the Biola Hour, the Biola is a very strong, traditionally dispensational school, which takes a very specific view of future. It's less so now. But their theme song was, "We've a story to tell to the nations that will turn their heart to the right." I can't remember how it goes on. And that's a classic post-millennial song. The story's going to turn the nations to the right. And in the 19th century, interestingly, post-millennialism and Darwinian evolution wedded together, and there was a huge surge of, we're bringing in the kingdom. And that was also combined with colonialism. So we're taking Christendom to the world. And that was part of the fuel of that. And then something happened, and it was almost like turning off a tap. Can you tell me what happened?
World War One.
It was a huge, for that particular branch of postmillennialism, it was a huge, how can you say Christendom is winning when Christendom's tearing the world apart? And there was a time in which it was almost impossible to find postmillennialists. It is a movement of some significance today, mainly among some reformed group who are one particular branch of reformed theology is kind of recaptured and the theonomy movement, reconstructionism, has brought back a certain amount of that, and there's a certain amount of it in charismatic circles, which look at the latter-day outpouring in which there will be a massive worldwide revival and bring in the kingdom. But in plain fact, it is very difficult to say that increasing gospel success will gradually produce a time in history prior to Christ's return in which faith, righteousness, and prosperity will prevail in the affairs of people and of nations. Looking objectively, is that the way you see the world going at the present time? It's really hard to see that. Now, by faith, you can see things that others can't see. But that's sort of where postmillennialism is in their particular understanding and view of that. It was often talked about the Puritan hope, because the Puritans were very much into a kind of postmillennialism. And one of the dangers of that, which is seen in certain Puritan history, was the tendency to a theocratic viewpoint, that the church will take over the state and will Christianize and produce in righteousness, and there will be a wedding of church and state with the church over the state. And occasionally there'll be some people from certain groups that will speak out of a post-millennial thing, and it sets everybody anxious because they're talking about theocracy, about the church should take over and impose God's law on the state. Well, let's talk about premillennialism. We'll come back and look at those last two. So premillennialism is the belief that Christ will physically and personally return to the earth after a period of tribulation and trial and the kind of growth of evil epitomized by the Antichrist. And when he returns, he will crush unbelievers and he will establish his kingdom physically on the earth. and will rule and reign on the earth. After 1,000 years, Satan will be released, as Revelation chapter 20 says, and then there will be a final defeat of Satan and his powers, and there will be the final great judgment and the establishment of the new heavens and the new earth. There are two categories of, broadly speaking, two categories of premillennialism. There's what we would call historic premillennialism, or what people who follow that tend to call historic premillennialism. There is very little doubt, we'll come back to this in a little bit, that the early church was premillennial. For the first two or three centuries, premillennialism was the dominant understanding that we have spoken of. And so they would go back and say, we're following the historic understanding of it. Most of these who would call themselves historic premillennialists, one of the main distinctions would be that they believe that the church will live through the tribulation period. So it's post-tribulational in that sense. The church will go through the tribulation period. The church will not be raptured ahead of time. And then the kingdom will be set up on an earth, and it will have Israel as a part of it, but not nearly as literal a part of it as the dispensational view has. And that's the second kind of millennial view, dispensationalism. Dispensationalism builds around the idea that God brought into being something new when he brought into being the church, that there's a distinction between Israel and the church, and that God has ordered history in different ways at different periods of time. There is a sense in which every Christian is a dispensationalist. And what I mean by that is that on one side of the cross, you brought sacrifices. After the cross, there were no sacrifices. It was through faith in Christ. So God has obviously two quite different economies, two kind of arrangements. Dispensationalism goes a little bit further than that and sees some other arrangements that God has established in history as well. So there's these distinct periods of time when God is operating under different principles. And some of it's relatively straightforward, and every Christian recognizes it in one form or another. Obviously, you have the original dispensation was that God created Adam and Eve, and they were in the garden, and they were in a perfect environment, and life was lived on one set of terms of a relationship to God. Then at the fall, they're not on the same arrangement that they were before sin entered. So you've got a pre-fall and a post-fall world. And then you have Abraham, and God begins to work out a program in history that very clearly is centered on Abraham and the way of faith and the nation of Israel coming into being and having a very distinct identity. And then you have the Mosaic covenant, which is, of course, a very specific arrangement that God makes with Israel, established at Mount Sinai. And then you have the New Testament, and then you have the kingdom, and then you have the eternal state. So there's these different periods in time. But the essential distinctions of dispensationalism is that there is a distinction between Israel and the church, that prophecy in the Old Testament, and we'll come back to this in a minute, ought to be interpreted in a, I'll use the word, normal way. And the reason I use the word normal is the word literal is misleading. When I read a book, I can tell when symbolic language is being used. So literal is too easily abused. I mean, when Jesus said, I am the door, nobody heard him say, I am 8.5 by however high a door is and wide a door is. You know, people recognize that. But there's a plain meaning or a normal meaning of that, which reads it in a historical, grammatical, contextual way. So as consistent as possible, a normal reading of the Old Testament and a distinction between Israel and the church, and not an absolute distinction, but a significant distinction, are the two main ideas of dispensationalism, and they have to be tested in terms of whether that's what the Bible teaches or doesn't teach. So next week, when we get into, I want to spend some time talking about the tribulation period and the rapture, because both of those relate to how we're going to see some things in the book of Revelation. And I want to try and read it as honestly as we can and work our way through it. But let's just see if there's any observations or questions related to postmillennialism and premillennialism. I'm glad if you solved all of those.
When you said that premillennialism was practiced or believed in the early church, did you mean by the disciples or the...
No, I'm talking about in the second and third centuries. Okay. We have people like Papias, early Christian leaders, Justin Martyr, and some of those. And then when you get to the city of Alexandria, it's interesting that it kind of focused... They were affected by two things. First of all, a more symbolic reading of Scripture, which came from Origen, which came out of a Greek background. Because one of their main complaints was that the view of premillennialists was way too material and materialistic. The real value is in the spiritual realm, not the physical realm. And that's very much part of Greek,
yeah,
you know, thought.
Still is.
So the spiritualizing, and the other part of it that has to be fitted in, and doesn't mean to make it right or wrong, but the other part was that there was growing distaste for Jews and Judaism because they had rejected the gospel. So there's no doubt there's some anti-Jewishness that got involved at that point. And so when Augustine came along later and the City of God became the great sort of classical work, and the great crisis was the destruction of the city of Rome and apparently civilization as it knew it, and he came with this distinction between the city of man, which is earthly and physical, and the city of God, which is spiritual and eternal, and the church is part of the... So amillennialism then, focused on the city of God, not the city of man, became the dominant idea. Sorry, that was more of an answer than you wanted.
No, but it helps because I was like, that doesn't make sense if it was the disciples, but I understand now if it's in the second.
Okay. Yeah. Carol Ann?
How can amillennialist or even the postmillennialist reconcile the 1,000 years? When would Jesus have started to reign if, I mean, it's already been 2,000 years? Almost.
Well, for somebody who's amillennial, the issue is that that's a spiritual reality. It's not a physical reality. And there's a fairly complicated way often that's done in terms of how you interpret Revelation chapter 20. They often see a division between chapter 19 and chapter 20, and chapter 20 is going back and recapitulating a spiritual idea rather than reading more consecutively through that. And they would say the 1,000 years is just a symbolic term. The numbers in the book of Revelation tend to be highly symbolic. That's just a symbolic number of perfection and completeness. 10 times 10 times 10, which is a special number. So the numbers are used as more symbolic statements than... And I should say, there's a point to that. I mean, numbers are used highly symbolically in the book of Revelation. So,
just out of curiosity, do even most premillennialists believe that the bodily reign of Christ on the earth after his return is actually going to be 1,000 years long?
There would be divisions between those. The historic premillennialists would not be... As they would think it's probably a symbol of perfection, and whether it's 1,000 years would not be significant. Dispensationalists would tend to say, you know, unless proven otherwise, I'm going to go with 1,000 years. Hardshell would say, yeah, it's 1,000 years, right to the day. Others like myself would say, I don't know that that's the important thing, is the length, I think. It's the reality of the physical presence of Christ on the earth, but... Okay, are you with me, not in terms of agreeing with me, but in terms of understanding where we are, getting some of those terms a little bit? Okay, so what I've put down here is a case, not the case, a case for premillennialism, and we don't have very long to do it, so let me try and go through this. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 2. Now, here's the basic issue. Premillennials tend to come to the Bible and say, we're reading the Old Testament and we're reading it on its own terms. Amillennialists or covenant theologians would come to say, we're Christians. We read the Old Testament in the light of the New Testament, and we interpret it in light of the New Testament. And the New Testament regularly took passages from the Old Testament and applied them in spiritual ways, which weren't precisely their specific ways. And premillennialists push back and say, hold on. In terms of the first coming, you're very insistent that it be interpreted literally. Bethlehem Ephrata meant Bethlehem Ephrata. A virgin meant a virgin. That one could be debated a little bit. The line of David meant the line of David. And so you read the Old Testament ones that are fulfilled at Christ's first coming literally. So now why jump symbolically, recognizing it's harder to see how these things are going to come into reality and so forth. But here's a passage, Isaiah chapter 2. The word that Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains and be lifted above the hills, and all the nations shall flow to it, and many people shall come and say, come, let's go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his paths, that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of Yahweh from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and decide disputes for many peoples, and they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, neither will they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Now, I think it's relatively safe to say, if you are hearing Isaiah give that message, and he says, it shall come in the latter days or the later days, that the mountain of the house of Yahweh shall be established as the highest of mountains. Well, the mountain of the house of Yahweh is what? Jerusalem, Mount Zion in Jerusalem. The house of Yahweh is clearly the temple in terms of what anybody in Isaiah's time would know. And it will be lifted above the hills. There will be geographical change. And all the nations will flow to it, and many peoples will come and say, let's go to the mountain of Yahweh, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we will walk in his paths. So there's going to be a movement among Gentile nations toward the Lord, and specifically toward Jerusalem. And out of Zion will go the law, the word of Yahweh from Jerusalem. Yahweh in this case, will judge between the nations. And so as you read that passage in Old Testament terms, you clearly get a picture of Jerusalem as the center in which Yahweh is specially present, and the nations are coming up, and the Lord is judging the nations in such a way that warfare between nation ends. So that is the way the passage seems to read. Amillennialists and premillennialists will say, amillennialists and postmillennialists will say, and they agree on this, the word that Isaiah the house of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem isn't about Judah and Jerusalem. It is about the church, the people of God. And when it says the mountain of the house of the Lord, it's talking about the church. And the church will be established above the hills, and all the people shall live in it. That's referring again to the evangelism and peoples from all nations coming into the church. And that when it says they go to the Lord so that he might teach us his ways and that they will walk in his paths, that is being people being discipled in the gospel. Now, obviously I have a bias as to how you are to understand that. Clearly, the average listener to Isaiah, and then the promises that are given to Abraham about a land, wasn't something that he would see as being symbolic. When God gave the dimensions of the land, he expected a physical land and to dwell in a physical land. So premillennialists would say, and we could go through a number of other passages, and I don't know that we have the time to do it, but they would say, we need to read the Old Testament on its own terms. The New Testament may enlarge on that promise. To give an illustration, one that's significant to some of the people in this group, that when the New Covenant promise is given in Jeremiah chapter 31, the promise in the New Covenant is that it's made to the house of Judah, very specifically in Jeremiah. In the New Testament, the church is the recipient of that. Now, amillennialism and postmillennialism tend to say, not all of them, but the great majority will tend to say, the fulfillment in the New Testament to the church cancels the promise to the Old Testament. And premillennialists come back and say, no, it may enlarge the promises, but it doesn't cancel the promises. That God will be faithful to keep his promise in literal terms that he made, that were promised and in good faith, understood in those terms, and he has the right to enlarge that and include us in those blessings ahead of time. But that doesn't cancel that. So amillennialism and postmillennialism tend to see no future for the nation of Israel. Those blessings have been transferred to the church. Now, there are a few exceptions, and one recent movement in amillennialism is to see some of those promises being fulfilled in the new heavens and the new earth. But I just want you to sense the difference between those two ways of reading the Old Testament. One takes it as it was written and then reads the New Testament and rejoices that we're included in some of those blessings, but doesn't see that that robs or removes, would be a fair way of saying, removes the blessings from Israel. Where the other says, no, the one cancels the other. You tracking with me here? So there's a way of reading the Bible, and one of the reasons I'm a premillennialist is because I think that way of reading the Bible is a more consistent way of reading the Bible. Second reason is what? I better look it up and see what I... A second one is that is related to the disciples and the kingdom. Now, one of the things that's very true as you read the New Testament is that the kind of things that are talked about in the Old Testament in great deal are not present in significant ways in the New Testament as Jesus comes. And Jesus comes preaching the kingdom, and there's a lot of talk about the kingdom, but many of the things that were talked about in the Old Testament and the land promises and all of those things aren't there. And so some will say, Jesus just didn't preach that kingdom that's present in the Old Testament. However, when Jesus came saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand," there was something that came to people's mind when they heard talking about the kingdom of heaven. Jesus doesn't ever define it. He just uses that term. Now, he's going to challenge many of the assumptions related to the kingdom that the Jewish people had. But the fact is that Jewish literature in the time prior to Christ's coming, the intertestamental literature, not the part that's in the Old Testament, had a very clear expectation of Messiah coming and establishing his kingdom on the earth. Now, we looked last week at Matthew chapter 19. And in Matthew chapter 19, Jesus is talking to his disciples. And he says to them, "Truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Now, he may not have meant that in literal terms, but you couldn't excuse the disciples if that's what they thoroughly expected that he meant, because that is absolutely consistent with the language of the Old Testament. He encourages them to believe that there's going to be a time when the 12 tribes will be restored, he will be ruling on his throne, and the disciples will share in that rule. That seems to me to be inescapable in that particular passage. And we read the passage in Luke 22 in which we have very similar language. Luke chapter 22 and verse 28. When, again, they're disputing about who's the greatest. And Jesus says, "You are those who stayed with me in my trials," Luke 22, 28. "I assigned to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Again, that seems to me to be highly consistent with an understanding of a literal kingdom on the earth ruled over by Messiah, as seems to be evidently, as a matter of fact, many amillennialists will say, if the Old Testament is to be interpreted in literal fashion, it talks about a kingdom like the premillennialists talk about. So they don't doubt that that's what it teaches. They just say it's been transcended in Christ and that form has been canceled and God has given us something better. In Acts chapter 1, it talks in the beginning of that, and it says in verse 3, "Jesus presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God." And now they're together for almost the last time, but Jesus has been with them talking for 40 days. So when they'd come together, verse 6 says, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And he said to them, "It's not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you shall receive power, the Holy Spirit come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses," and so forth. But what stands out is the question. He'd been spending 40 days with them after the resurrection, talking about the kingdom of God, and either they were totally inept in understanding him, or there was a reason they asked, "Is this the time you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He had not taken away that understanding and that hope. And his answer isn't, "It isn't going to happen." His answer is, "It isn't for you to know the times or the seasons," which is very different than saying, "No, you've got it wrong." And that would seem to be a natural thing for the Lord to say, but Luke allows it to sit there. So there's other things I could say, but it seems, and it's not a major theme. Obviously, the major theme in the New Testament is the establishment of the church, the new thing God is doing, his eternal purpose centered in the church. The church wasn't an afterthought of God. God didn't begin the church because the Jews rejected the kingdom. All of that was part of his purpose. He started the church because that was his eternal purpose in Christ, and it was created and established before the foundation of the world. Older dispensationalists said some things that were completely wrong on those kind of issues. But there is this continuing belief that's in their hand. Quickly, let me just look at the next two because time's caught us here. Romans chapter 11. And this one is one that we'd spend a lot more time on. But in Romans chapter 9 to 11, Paul is talking about the relationship between his ministry to Israel and what's happened. And he's brokenhearted over the rejection by the Jews of the gospel. Now, let me go back to chapter 9, actually, before we go any further, but I want you to see this. Israel is a distinct nation among the nations of the earth. It's God's set apart people. God will say, even in the strong words of Malachi chapter 1, Jacob I've loved, Esau I've hated. Israel's his chosen people. Chapter 9, it says, I'm speaking the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. They are Israelites. And to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them beyond the patriarchs and from their race, according to the flesh, is the Christ who is God over all, blessed forever. So when he's talking about Israel, he begins by talking about their uniqueness and their privileges and their promises. And then he will talk about the fact that they've rejected the gospel. And it will be because they think that they can establish their own righteousness. And he will say in the middle of it, there are those who think that they are Israel, and they're not because they are unbelieving. And then in chapter 11, he comes to talk about what is happening. And what happens in chapter 11 is that he begins, notice in verse 1, I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. And he talks about a number of other things that go through here. And he talks about how the fact that they've stumbled, and they've stumbled over the stumbling block, who is Christ. They did not believe. Verse 11. Did they stumble in order that they may fall? By no means. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. That's a remarkable statement. What's God's plan in history? Well, he's going to cut off the Israelites, Israel, as a nation because of their unbelief, and he's going to bring in Gentiles. And one of his reasons for bringing in Gentiles is to make Jewish people jealous for the privilege that believers have. And then he goes on to say, if their trespass, Israel's trespass, means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? And then he goes on to give an analogy, and the analogy is to say, you Gentiles, quit being so proud. The only reason you were grafted in is because of God's grace. And so don't think you're superior to Israel. But Israel has a future. Verse 25. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I want you to understand this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come upon Israel. Now that's the nation of Israel, and it's a hardening, it says, in part. It's in part because it's not complete. Paul's an Israelite, and he's a believer. He's still, and so are the disciples. So it's partial. It's not complete. And then he'll go on to say, and it's temporary, not permanent. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, and in this way, or and thus, all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob, and this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. And in Isaiah chapter 59, and then Isaiah 27, those passages are taken of with a little bit of Jeremiah 31 thrown in. As regards the gospel, they are enemies of God for your sake. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. And why do I believe that there's a future for Israel? Because they are God's elect people, and his election is irrevocable. He will set them aside for a time in judgment, but the promise is when the fullness of Gentiles comes in, all Israel will be saved. And he quotes Old Testament passages about their salvation and their forgiveness related to the coming of Messiah. Now, some will say that the word Israel, and thus all Israel will be saved, is a reference to the church and to believers in the church. But the word Israel or Israelite is used 11 times in chapters 9 to 11, and every other time it means ethnic Israel. So it's extremely unlikely that suddenly he gives it a new meaning right here, and then goes back to quote the statement, on behalf of God, they are, what does it say in verse 11? As regards the gospel, they, clearly meaning Israel, are enemies of God. So it's Israel that's in the focus here, and the promise is Israel as a whole will be saved. That's God's promise for the future. To my mind, that's a very strong statement, and I find attempts to move around it to be unconvincing. For the sake of time, let me just notice the last two. Revelation 19 and 20, and without going into it in detail, Revelation 19 shows the coming of Christ physically to earth and the destruction of the beast and the false prophet and the kingdom and the rebellion of those who rebelled against God. Then in chapter 20, you have resurrection, you have the establishment of the kingdom and the saints rule with Christ for 1,000 years. And then you have a rebellion, and then you have the new heavens and the new earth. It looks like we're supposed to read straight through and not suddenly see chapter 20 as a jumping back or a spiritual, because if you take chapter 19 as the physical, literal, bodily resurrection that we talked about, or coming of Christ that we talked about, and the new heavens and the new earth refer to a real coming of the eternal state, to suddenly spiritualize that part's in between and say that that's not connected when you read it through requires some significant jumps of exegesis at that particular point. And so, to my mind, the natural reading of Revelation 19 and 20 and 21, to read through that, causes you to believe that the order is the return of Christ, the destruction of Antichrist, the establishment of Christ's rule on earth, ruled over by resurrected believers, and then the eternal state at the end of that, after the final judgment. So it's the logic of Revelation 20 that compels me. And then the last one we already mentioned, but let me just read to you, and I could have read more, but it's not obviously out of time. Here's Justin Martyr. And Justin Martyr is writing about 160 AD. I and every other completely Orthodox Christian feel certain that there will be a resurrection of the flesh, followed by 1,000 years and the rebuilt, embellished city of Jerusalem, as when it was announced by the prophets Ezekiel, Isaiah, and others. That's fairly directly premillennial. Doesn't answer some of the specific questions that come up and will be what we'll talk about. But we feel certain there will be a resurrection of the flesh followed by 1,000 years in the rebuilt, embellished city of Jerusalem. It's talking about a physical reign of Christ on the earth at that particular time, which is consistent with premillennialism. Well, you also have Irenaeus, Tertullian, Lactantius, the Epistle of Barnabas, Papias, as others who speak in those particular terms. There's no clear evidence for anyone who wasn't premillennial in the second and third century. Then you begin to see more and more voices speaking in a different direction. Now, I know this seems pretty technical to some of you. To some of you, it seems wrong because you think I'm wrong, and that's fine, too. You're entitled to be wrong. I remember hearing M.R. DeHaan, who was part of the radio Bible class and was famous for having a famous gravelly voice, and my voice gets more and more like it as time goes on, saying, when I heard him speak, he said, and he was from Grand Rapids, strong Reformed community, strongly differing from his understanding of future things. But he said, I've told my wife, I want to be buried next to an amillennialist. So when the Lord comes on the way up, I can say, I told you so, I told you so. Well, I'm not quite that confident, but listen, this is a second order issue. Sincere Christians who love Christ understand these things in different ways. And we can tussle, but we tussle like brothers, not like enemies, if Christ is in his right place in your understanding of it. Any last chance at questions that you want to have? I know that you've endured more than you can deal with. Elizabeth.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I like that we can get along with this. But I also like the fact that when I open a book, I have some consistent guidelines so that when I get to poetry, I know how that needs to work. When I get to history, if the scripture is a history book, it's God's history, then it seems like I'd like to have something consistent and not get to a certain chapter and say, well, I'm going to make this symbolic, because I mean, there's lots of things there. I just from my readings of books on how to read the Bible and how to study it, the appeal to a consistent hermeneutic would come out as very important. Maybe first.
Yeah, I don't doubt the importance of it, and I happen to agree. But on the other hand, I do want to say that. You read the Old Testament in some measure inevitably from the framework of who Christ is. So that when you read the law, you read it through the light of the New Testament justification by faith, so that you're not reading the same covenant as a covenant that has to be kept as the Jews understood that they were under the law and so forth. So there is a sense in which the point that we have to read from the perspective of the finished work of Christ is true. The question is, does it alter the framework that entirely? To understand that some things were temporary is different from saying that everything becomes symbolic, which is what the other view tends to do. So.
Okay, I know I'm dense, but the difference between historic premillennialism and dispensationalism is how they view Israel, the role they give Israel in the future.
It is more how they difference? Yeah. There's a certain amount of distinction. They would not draw that distinction as strongly, okay. But it's more the issue of related to the tribulation? Is the church present in the tribulation?
Okay, and you thought the first believers thought they would live through the tribulation.
Yeah, that was not an issue that's addressed very clearly. Okay. We don't have those kind of details. That's why I said that's a pretty broad strokes kind of.
So it's very little difference between the two is what you're saying.
I would say that we don't have the specifics of and we don't have evidence of that people go back and they try to read things, but there's nothing very convincing about them discussing and debating the issue of they just knew the Lord was going to come and He was going to set up His kingdom, and they had more pressing questions in some ways. Very interesting book called The Progress of Dogma by James Orr, and he points out that. You can see certain issues becoming pressing at different times in history. The first issues that had to be settled were about the person of Christ. And then it had to be settled about what's the relationship of Christ between Christ and God, Trinity. The Father and God the Son, and the whole issue of the Trinity. Then it came, well, what's the relationship between the deity and humanity of Christ? How could they coexist in one person? Some of you are walking through church history, know how those became the issues. Then it came to be the nature of the church. Does it bestow grace, or is it, and all, that tends to go all the way to the Reformation. Eschatology doesn't become a big thing in terms of the main focus, because reality until the 1800s. Was primarily when that becomes a big focus. And even today, I mean, some of the issues that we're thinking about today are forced on us by our culture. So spend an inordinate amount of time talking about things that are hugely secondary to the main things, and yet they aren't. I mean, who wants to spend all their time thinking and talking about homosexuality and gender issues? But you can't live in this culture and not be speaking to that and be faithful. So some of that goes on in church history. Okay, Nikki, the last one, and then we'll release people from the tribulation that this is beginning to feel like.
So I was just recently reading in Luke where someone comes to Jesus and says, "My father is dying," and He tells him, "Let the dead bury their dead. You go and preach the kingdom." So I'm wondering, is the word kingdom in the New Testament always referring to this future millennial kingdom, or are there other uses?
The kingdom was inaugurated in the presence of the king, and then the people of the kingdom begin to gather. So we are kingdom citizens already before the kingdom has come in its fullness. The Lord Jesus gathered people around Him. We're children of the kingdom, but He still taught them to pray, "Your kingdom come," because there is an already, not yet, kingdom. And the kingdom will not be fully realized until Jesus returns in glory and things are put in their proper order. So the kingdom is present, but it's present in, as it were, veiled form, because the king is not present. And it needs the king to put the kingdom in place, kind of thing. And that's one of the challenges of postmillennialism, to try to have the kingdom without the king gets things backwards, but especially when you get into church-state issues. Okay, I'm worn out, and I trust that you aren't, but I know you are. So next week, we'll look at the tribulation and the rapture, just to get those issues sort of in front of us. I'll talk about why I take what views I take, but those are third-order issues. And so I was reading somebody today and said, what if I was, somebody gave me a thing recently and said, what if I said wrong? What if you're wrong in terms of your understanding of, and you ended up going through the rapture, the tribulation, and the person said, well, I think I'd lose my faith. Well, if your faith is in an understanding of the pre-trib rapture, you're trusting the wrong thing. That's the best that I think we can do in trying to put together the pieces, but there's no explicit statement. So it's a third order issue, but it's still important for us as we go through Revelation. Okay? I'm here to answer any questions you have, or to say I don't know the answer.